My childhood was pretty ideal in a lot of ways. However, there was definitely like some really undertones of like alcoholism and like mental health and just a lot of problems in the family too. There's that, but it seemed like when we were kids it wasn't super focalized on the terrible. I think I became aware of it when I started probably like smoking pot at like 12 and like selling weed and like kind of seeing like an underbelly of the community that I was in at this like private school. My brother was like a drug dealer, and so I just was like by proxy kind of became like a little bit of a pot dealer at, like in sixth grade, you know. So I went to Catholic school for like my whole life. Like I wasn't comforted by adults at that point about like the world being okay or like me being okay, because these substances like changed my like perspective on like how I felt.
Hey, Dan, say chunks. Oh, it's coming closer. Oh, there's a close up. There's a close up.
I realized I was gay at like 8 years old, and that's when everybody realized I had super bad dyslexia. They put me in special ed, and from there I was so isolated from everybody. That whole thing really fucked with my life, and that's when I started trying to commit suicide, was in, you know, about second grade. I was at the point where I was trying to like put plastic bags over my head, and that almost trumps, but not in the same way as having electrocompulsion therapy at, I think I was 19. Yeah, so fuck everybody, like my life was way harder and I deserve the things that are given to me at this point, whatever it is, so.
I have a story to share that was really instrumental in my life that has to do with this. This woman, she was a very close friend of mine, and she got depressed. And she was always kind of extreme in ways, and she said she decided that what she was going to do was she was going to go with it, and she was going to go to bed and just see where it went. And she was this beautiful, you know, woman. And so she went to bed, she got more depressed and more depressed, and she went to bed basically for a year. She gained 100 pounds, and then she said she realized there was no bottom. And she said by the time she realized there was no bottom, she couldn't get out of it. Mm. And so that's always, that always scared me, and
yeah,
it always kept me from going to bed, right? Mm-hmm. Or even an hour, because I saw the momentum of that take her.
God.
Are you okay?
Do
you
want to yeah, stop? No, it's, no, I'm good.
There's some that fell behind there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, but no, it's just sad because it was like, that was like the last resort they had for me. It was like, we're gonna just shock your brain and give you like, in like, you know, induce seizures several times for months.
And that was at 19.
At 19. And a lot of really bad shit came from that because I remember feeling so bad about like having so much like attention brought to me and having like be like, and the electroconvulsion therapy was just like, I felt like it was really made me feel guilty for like having such privilege to have access to all this mental health resources, even though it's like super fucked up. But just, I remember being like, oh yeah, there's the medical bills were like over, you know, just like millions, you know, so it was like crazy to think about. And I remember some dark things, like, after that, like, living in New York City, feeling so guilty about how much money was spent on me, that I was just started, like, consuming, like, really, like, things that are not edible, just because I felt so, like, utter trash of, like, just, I don't know, just feeling so, like, not, like, I deserve, like, just pain and suffering, because I, like, I don't know.
How do you, that's hard. How did you get out of it? Or what, when did things start changing for you?
I mean, things probably started changing when I was like, I didn't really, like, I've just changed a lot of things about me from each experience that I've had. So all those, like, times that I've spent in, like, hospitals, like, I've spent, like, over a year in a hospital, like, throughout my entire life collectively, like, in confined to, like, a room for, like, a year. It's, like, absolutely insane. And it's a trauma that is dark, because the people they put there are not people that get better always. I'm functioning. I go to school, I have a job, it's like, I'm functioning, but I don't know. Like, yeah.
You are functioning! You know that.
I guess, yeah. But, I mean, it is scary because I've been some places where they were like, you know, you're not going to get better, probably. And I managed to get somewhat okay, which is good. Which is better than, you know, suicidal or...
I'm going to keep asking you this question every interview we do. What gives you hope?
Actually, breath gives me hope. Because I think of espoir, in French means hope, and it also means aspire. Like, it reminds me of inhalation and exhalation. Yeah. So,
breath? I like it.
What keeps you hope?
I don't really know. And I think that's why I want to make this documentary. Like, I actually like being depressed. It's comforting. It's like a blanket. I don't have to try. I don't have to do anything. It's like I can just lay in my bed and, like, I'm happy, you know? Hope is just as important, and that's what I find interesting about it. It's like what makes you want to get out of that bed, like that comfy, comfy place. Like, even though you feel like shit and, like, you're sad, it's like, why would I get out of, if it feels so comfortable to me, why would I want to get out of it?